A lot of people in the media like to just think that this tour was never gonna happen. For months and months and months before we played the first show, it was like, this tour is never gonna run off the ground. There we were at RFK.
That tour that everybody said it shouldn't happen just because it's too cool a tour. And we have such a camaraderie with the Metallica guys, so it's sort of like this little mini army that's just going against all standards and all the rules or history.
The Guns N' Roses Metallica tour is one of the most anticipated tours of the year. Rarely do two bands this hugely successful tour together. By the end of their 25-show U.S. tour, Guns N' Roses and Metallica will have played to over 800,000 people.
One of the big things I learned was that everybody had wanted this tour so bad and worked so hard to make it, to be able to do this tour, you know, Metallica through their touring and through our touring, to be able to do a stadium tour together, that we thought that when we got here, it'd just be perfect, it'd be so cool. Well, it kind of turned out to be that, wait a minute, this is so cool that why shouldn't this be the hardest thing we've ever done?
What you basically have out here is you have two full, you know, you have all the steel and all that crap, but you have two bands that have basically each their own production. We have our whole thing with the mirrors and the snake pit and drum kits and flip around everywhere and all that kind of crap.
We have a horn section now, and we've had for a while. Mm-hmm. And another, we have Teddy Andriotis, he plays harmonica and keyboards as well. So we have that, we have backup singers.
Wanted to do this right and give the kids, you know, I mean, we could have saved hundreds of thousands of dollars a week if we had had the same stage set up, both of us, the same lighting rig, the same everything.
We didn't feel it would be right for Metallica to come and do like a normal open, like an opening act amount of playing time on stage. That would really be unfair to their show and would, like, you know, kind of make them look smaller, and we didn't want to do that. We wanted them to look as big as they are.
McKagan. It's a couple hours before the show, and Duff's going to take us around back here to show us how this stage set is actually put together. After Metallica goes off, it can take up to about 2 hours for their stage set to be ready, and Duff's going to show us what they're actually doing during that time.
I don't know.
You ready?
I don't know how they do it.
You better know.
I'll wing it.
Welcome to the jungle.
That's Axel. And the reason it says no smoking is because oxygen tank.
What do you do to keep your voice in good shape? Do you drink honey and tea, or what's this?
Ginseng? Honey and tea.
Honey and tea. How many drinks do you keep with you on stage?
I have three.
Are they tuned differently?
No.
Or they're exactly the same?
I've broken like six of them.
That's a monitor board.
These guys get fired most often. These guys. Let's walk out there. Come on.
Hi, bro.
I've never done this before. This is Teddy's washboard. Isn't that cool?
And this is my stuff.
You know, my old punk rock thing and vests and...
Your new punk rock stuff?
What's no, this is Gianni Versace.
Ah, very nice. He seems to be a favorite among the band, that designer.
Yeah, he loves us too. It's a slash of stuff.
Wow, those are really nice. I haven't seen these ones yet. I guess that's when he plays tennis.
Slash, I never knew. Okay.
What do you do for
Water ski.
Water ski.
Yeah.
Why is that? Have you always water skiing, or is this
a new thing? I was in a competition water skiing.
Really?
You know, yeah, I used to be really active in sports, and I used to play football, and I was in gold gloves, boxing, baseball, and basketball.
Then how did you end up in a band? How did you have time to learn how to play guitar?
I don't know. Help me. I don't know.
There's a lot of people we get to play in front of that probably wouldn't come see us. I don't know. So it worked good for us.
Do you think that a typical Guns fan is someone that also likes Metallica?
Probably now. Hopefully.
This tour is a perfect example of, you know, there's a great package. You know, I could have never ever seen this. You know, recession or not, nobody's gonna miss this.
People, you know, we're out, you know, co-headlining with Guns N' Roses. You guys out with Guns N' Roses, and then you get the next minute or two, you get everything that just is like the bad stuff. I mean, and it's funny how general people, because when you play to 50,000 people as opposed to 15, it's a lot more a general audience. Do you know what I mean? And they just know Bad Boy Rocker, Axl Rose.
It's been really easy growing about a lot of this stuff lately, so to give credit where credit's due, I know what his reputation is.
How do you think that's he's changing, though? Is he just
he's just been a lot more positive and a lot more willing to deal with sort of the possible technical pitfalls. Instead of like shying away from it and just getting pissed off and making it worse, he actually is into making everything better.
And a really good monitor man.
I read that you said for like 7 years of therapy in 1 year or something.
Yeah, I mean, I was like, you know, I'd come off stage and either get on the phone or have the person fly out personally and do 4 or 5 hours right after stage, of, you know, where like someone goes like, once a week to like work out their problems for like a half hour, an hour, and I was doing 4 or 5 hours a day, right. You know, like every day.
Is it helping?
And you were at the show tonight, it seems to be fine, and I'm in a good mood now.
Yeah.
So. Any negative aspect I gotta turn into something bigger. Like if we did a long show and you know, we did a show where we played like 3.5 hours in one of the Carolinas, North Carolina or something, like Greensboro, North Carolina. Then there was this comic book about how the crowd was bored and leaving and there was no one there.
It's well, like they didn't seem
some
bored.
Of the people in the back were leaving because they had to get up in a couple hours for work or something.
I mean, I remember when I was a kid, man, waiting for Aerosmith for hours in their partying right. days. And just everything's changed.
People now, at least the younger kids, are very into, I mean, they want something more than the last person did, you know?
Right.
Maybe they're a bit spoiled.
What about the people who are actually paying to come see Guns N' Roses and Metallica play? We wanted to find out what they thought of the show.
Have you guys ever been backstage before?
No, never.
No, is this what you expected?
No.
Not really. What did you guys expect?
Trash.
Naked girls, stuff like that?
Exactly.
That's why you guys are here, you know? As far as this tour and stuff, I mean, is this like the biggest thing probably you guys are going to see, like, you know, while you're going to concerts and stuff?
I think it is to me. I was excited when I was on my way here. I mean, I was
stepping everywhere.
I never thought I'd see Guns N' Roses or Metallica or anything, and I was like, oh god. So we kind of paid like a lot of money for our tickets.
Big bucks.
Yeah. But it's worth it.
My paycheck thanks you.
I'm gonna ask you some questions that people ask me, and sometimes like, I mean, they're always asking me about, you know, what about the kids? Do you worry about the kids? Does a concert this big, like, worry you guys that it's gonna be trouble? Are you guys gonna get in trouble or anything?
No way.
No way?
No way.
No, it's your first one.
It's not worrying me at all.
You feel safe?
Sure. Of course.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, don't trust us. So our reputation doesn't bother you guys about going to the show or anything,
that's
right?
That's why we're here.
Houston is a pretty wild town. We try to extend our trip. Whenever we come to Texas, we like hanging in Texas.
What's your favorite city?
Probably one of my favorite cities is New Orleans. In America, anyway. It's a really strange, strange place. I don't think there's like another city in the world like New Orleans.
I've played clubs in New Orleans for like the last like 7 years, and I've played everywhere in New Orleans. Every time I played there, we've made that joke, oh yeah, we're playing the Superdome. You know, when we just drove in to play it, it's like we're looking at it, we really are playing it.
Well, I hear also when you were in New Orleans, as sort of the antithesis of the Superdome, you went to a small club and just got on stage.
Yeah, we always do that.
You do?
Yeah.
And some kid came over, and there was a club next door, and he said, you want to jam with our band?
Yeah, great.
I don't love sitting around my hotel room doing nothing. If I was going to pick something to spend my time with that I like doing, it'd be playing. So
do you miss playing smaller places?
No, because I do it all the time now.
Right.
We have these great parties that Axl's been kind of putting on, other theme parties. We've had the Indianapolis night where they brought in the two Formula One cars.
And bought like a big checkered rug and had a bunch of girls, you know, like that look like, you know, when somebody wins a race, they have the girl that kisses the guy.
Is this the room where it would be?
No.
No, okay.
I think the theme party would be, where is it? Not there.
We had a voodoo night, and we had a Roman like orgy type night, a toga party, and they had these big muscle guys bringing in a pig, roasted pig, at 4 a.m. Of course, you know, who wants to eat a roasted pig?
And the one in Disney where all that went around wearing mouse ears.
Basically, what it is you know, this tour for us is like the ultimate thing, you know, and we're gonna take advantage of it in every way. So it's like we want a circus.
When you play these stadiums and stuff like that, every show has kind of a different personality. And you know, when we played in Pittsburgh, for instance, the whole time we were on stage, it was just pissing down. And
raining?
Yeah, raining. Yeah, raining. And, you know, for like 2.5 hours, you're just out there in these like storms and stuff, and it really created like a great vibe.
New York shows went really good.
Why?
It just happened, I guess. When we're on later in the night, you know, when it's all dark, you get to utilize your lights more, and I think we look better in the dark.
You mentioned Giant Stadium. The first night was a really good show.
Mm-hmm.
Was that because the fans were nuts? Was that because
weren't nuts? You know? There was just more energy coming off of them, and I think a lot of it to do was with Babs and Mike Monroe were standing on the side of the stage, and that made me really happy. And it was just like, you know, just go off. I was really happy that they were there.
Who's Babs?
Sebastian.
Sebastian. Yeah. Okay.
And Mike Monroe, and right. That just was made me like just work harder. I really liked that. And the second night in Giant Stadium was, you know, I got hit with a couple things a couple different times. Once when I was like thanking the crowd, and then I got hit later. It was just kind of like, no,
I'm not, you know, I'm not gonna allow this.
Seems like Guns N' Roses have packed a whole career of controversy into just one tour. The Guns N' Roses Metallica shows have not gone off without a hitch. There have been riots, legal hassles, and technical problems.
You haven't noticed I ain't playing a guitar tonight. For obvious reasons.
Montreal was just really creepy. Nothing against the people in Montreal. We had a great time hanging out there. I think it was the building itself.
It was like the first show back after like 4 dates, so Axl had some problems with his throat and so on. So we're back again, Montreal. Everybody was very excited to be back and playing, and for the first hour and 10 minutes or whatever we played, I mean, it was great. We were really, it was really good for us. It was looking to be one of the best ones.
Basically, our pyro guy will come in and say, you know, if something's going to be changed. If not, he won't come in there and everything will be the same every night. He came in and said, okay, the fade to black stuff is going to be out on the wings, so don't go out there. I said, okay. But he didn't specify that it was in addition to what's already there. So I walked from the wings right onto where one of them was and just...
The last couple seconds before the cue, I knew it was just eerie. I could just tell that he shouldn't be standing where he was standing. And then the flame from hell just comes. It's like moving down the stage, 8 feet tall, and just completely engulfs him.
We got a friend of ours, brought him out from a band called Metal Church. He's filling in for us. I want you to give Mr. John Marshall a hand over here. All right.
So how are you? What is the prognosis with your arm? Let's get that over with.
It sucks. I mean, it's burnt. it was minor second degree, most of this arm and a little on the back of this one, but the back of the hand is where it was the worst. I mean, right here is okay, it's where my wristband was, so I'm all right here. Should have had a longer wristband.
When I left the hotel and they said James was burnt, I knew so. I just felt it. It just felt wrong. So we hustled on as soon as we could. It was a couple hours people were waiting. So already they were like, ugh, you know. And when we got up there, they were just really dead and people were sitting down. And
what happened then? I mean, you got out there and
we got out there,
you played anyway.
The PA fed back the entire time. The monitors fed back the entire time. The crowd was like non-existent.
We had just stopped the tour because I had throat problems. Came back and I realized I'm going to hurt myself.
Right.
I told Slash 2 more songs. If we can't get it fixed, I got to go. You know? And then we did more than 2 more songs. And finally, I was just kind of like, I don't know what to do. And I looked over and Gilby was like, dude, I can't hear. And
I mean, it was driving me crazy.
And Duff was like, I can't hear either.
Yeah,
and we had a little huddle kind of and was like, we're out of here.
I've gotten to the point where I'm starting to realize how powerful an effect having the band come to town really is, you know? So, I mean, in all due respect to the people that got pissed off or disappointed by any of the situations that went down, we were just being as real as humanly possible about our own situation. At this point, we've been through so much, and I've gotten to the point where I just look at life and just go, you take the good with the bad and just deal with it instead of stressing. You know, I mean, obviously there's a lot of stress all the time anyway, but I try and control it as much as possible. So I'm pretty laid back and just like, okay, what's the problem? What's the solution for it? And try and deal with it on a logical level. And then you get to go out there and blow steam on stage for 2.5 hours.
Right.
I think there's a happy medium in there without having to kick anybody's ass or you know, start a riot.
Yeah, I vent. You like traditional drummer crap.
Bang on things?
Yeah. I hit things for a living.
I guess playing must sort of be venting.
Yeah, that's
too,
that's,
you know,
the best release for me. That's why I started playing drums, you know.
Really? Because you were angry?
I was, yeah. At something.
You don't know what?
Yeah, I do. You know, just life in general, my life at the time.
Do you feel like you had a tough childhood?
Maybe. Yeah. But, you know, it was my way of getting it out. You know, it was great. I'd come home from school every day and just thrash. And right after that, I'd feel really good and mellow and just kind of, you know.
Therapeutic.
Very therapeutic.
Do you do
I'd say for anybody out there that, like let's say people down in, like, East L.A. that want to go out and beat somebody up, why don't you just buy a drum kit or something, you know? Really. Beat on a drum. Don't beat on each other or something. I think that'd be a great motto for the world. You know, everybody buy a drum set. You know? And when you feel like you want to go, like, hit your kid or something, you know, just go into the room and just play a beat.
Is there a physical regimen that you go through before you go on stage? Do you do anything special?
If I notice that I'm getting run down, if I notice I have a show where I'm really tired, then I get back into a workout program. And I have, like, this special machine called a ROM that you can do a half-hour workout in 4 minutes. You know, it's like this thing some scientist built in UCLA. And I have that on the road, and I use that. We work with a chiropractor who, you know, little by little, you know, he helps keep all the muscles in tune and everything. You know, I'm on a vitamin program and stuff like that, basically just general health, but something I've never concentrated on, and this show, the way we perform, demands it.
What's keeping this together is the respect that we have for each other and the desire to just make this happen and kind of shove it down people's throats, you know what I mean? And proving to people that the tour, you know, I mean, they said it would never happen, and I mean, it's a great thing to be out here and proving them wrong, despite all the difficulties that we run into, you know?
Something very Spinal Tap about this whole thing.
Nobody's seen this for 100 years.